Good morning, everyone. The title of my presentation has changed slightly. It's Islam and Nonviolent Violent Action Towards a General Theory. I do study the questions pertaining to religion and nonviolence separately, so this particular conference was a wonderful opportunity to try and combine them together. I also come from a particular epistemological intellectual tradition which takes positivism and the rational cost-benefit calculation seriously, which may at times be seen as somewhat cynical, and yet I think it would add value to our overall discussion here of the issues. Well, there is quite a bit of evidence, both anecdotal and case studies, which suggests the effectiveness of nonviolent action for groups, protesting groups, to achieve their stated ends. In fact, theorization on nonviolence tells that nonviolent actions are more superior in terms of morality than violence. Further, nonviolence signals to the authorities that their physical integrity is not going to be challenged, meaning that they can meet with the protesters and actually not fear for their physical security. Also, the jiu-jitsu of nonviolence has a potential to knock off balance of the rival parties. Specifically, it has a potential to divide the government where you might have the hawks that would like to use violence against the protesters, against the nonviolent participants, and those who are more responsible and moral within the government and would not want to respond in this particular way against the protesters. So one of the puzzles, though, which comes, and in fact, there is an increasing empirical statistical evidence which shows that nonviolent actions are more effective than violence. But then this begs the question as to why we still do have a minority of groups that employ violence. We don't really know much about the conditions which would address this particular issue, but there have been a couple of studies which would speak about the democracy and the level of state repression as explanatory factors as to why groups would choose to employ nonviolence or violence. And yes, more recently, people have also suggested education as one of the factors that can diminish the communication cost, that can inculcate the ideas of nonviolent action into the participants. Here I would like to build on this particular literature by bringing in the factor of religion. And specifically, just to be a little bit more focused, I decided to go with Islam. So we do know quite a bit, I guess, I don't know whether we know, but we do hear quite a bit about the connection, the link between Islam and violence. But we don't hear from the public discourse much about the link between Islam and nonviolence. However, there is quite a number of case study work in the tradition of in the intellectual tradition of nonviolence that actually does single out Muslim majority societies as ones where nonviolence is possible. One of the foundational studies of nonviolence, actually a father of the nonviolent studies, Gene Sharp, would in fact speak in passing about a group of Pathans, or the Pashto people, who we know now, back in the 70s, where he would not necessarily look into the issue of religion there. I think it was more the discussion of masculinity. But this particular extended example was quite important. Here, he would say that nonviolent action has been used by groups which have been famous for their very aggressive behavior and violence. And he's talking about the Pathans in the Northwest frontier province of British India during the time when India was under the British Raj. And he would quote an observation that was made in 1896 that the The true pattern is cruel, bloodthirsty, and vindictive in the highest degree, and he leads a wild, free, active life in the rugged fastness of his mountains. So it's a very, I guess, mountains culture. And there is an air of masculine independence about him. But then, and of course, he would bring the idea of Islam that Pathans were Muslims, adherents of religion, widely regarded as a proving of war for a good cause. Yet, among these Pathans, Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, the frontier Gandhi, organized a powerful movement of the Khudai Khidmatkar, or the servants of God. And this particular movement pledged to complete nonviolence, and those and whose members became some of the bravest and most daring and reliable nonviolent resistors of India's struggle for independence. So it seems pretty much clear from this extremely important case that there was no basic change in human nature of the Pathans, but the aggressiveness, bravery, and daring of those people find new nonviolent expression through the nonviolent techniques, according to Gene Sharp. We then also do see, interestingly, the case of Palestinians who are not widely regarded as somebody who conduct a nonviolent struggle, but in the 80s, 90s, during the time of the first Intifada, the Palestinian struggle was seen more as nonviolent than violent. An extensive case of Kosovo, studied by Howard Clark, who just recently passed away, speaks about the issue of Kosovo, which did start as actually nonviolent resistance, but then because of escalation of the conflict and the state repression from Serbia, I guess the nonviolent faction was defeated by the Kosovo Liberation Army. The case of Tatarstan, the case of Kyrgyzstan, Bangladesh, Egypt, Iran, again, are some of the cases which are recently being highlighted. In fact, there is a recent book by edited by Bartkovsky, that would in a way bring in and try to recover this nonviolent activism throughout the world. The Muslim majority states were also a part of it. What's interesting, though, is that in some of these cases, nonviolence develops in spite of religion. So, in fact, when we think about Kosovo and Egypt, their nonviolent struggle was against their core religionists, and the same was also true for Bangladesh versus West Pakistan at this point. But the importance of the studies is that they do show that nonviolence is a possibility in Muslim majority societies. So there is a tradition of this, and it's important to recover this particular tradition. Later, we do see the studies which would actually link nonviolent action directly to religious groups, to Islamic religious groups. Again, in the same volume, there was a study of Algeria, and it was explicitly stated that the Sufi orders of Algeria and family networks were employing nonviolent tactics against the French colonial rule. And we do know that it was a very, very bloody war later on of when the French basically would have to leave what they considered to be just another part of France, just on the other side of the pond. But therefore, perhaps this tradition of nonviolence was lost back then, but again, it was there, and it's important to remember it. There was also recently quite a number of studies, and thanks to the conferences, like this, that would elaborate on the Turkish contribution to nonviolent movements. A case in point is a sociological study by Gurbuz and Bernstein, where they would compare to Turkish movements, the National Outlook, Milli Görüş, that would use the protests in the streets, and the Gülen movement that would use more subtle tactics. In fact, studying the Gülen movement, they would propose a new concept of strategic non-confrontation as a form of nonviolent protest. And they would, in fact, expand on the previous focus that nonviolent studies had of power as being in the almost exclusively in the realm of the state, and would try to extend this into the larger construction of power in the society, that the foci of power may lie not only in the state but in the society as a whole. Consequently, it's there is this particular idea that they were trying to bring in together. Then Sartre Park study actually would link the literature on nonviolence to the Islamic theology, and would actually speak about the would interpret the hadith and the Quranic verses through the perspective of nonviolence. He would speak about the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, for example, and the actions as an example of nonviolent resistance when, for the sake of peaceful pilgrimage, the hard conditions of the Meccan idol worshippers had been accepted by the Prophet, which would include disarming himself in order to enter the city and putting himself and the followers under great risk. Consequently, one of the hypotheses to explore is really the connection between Islam and nonviolence, that adherence to Islam may lead to nonviolent action. We also do know quite a bit, I guess, hear quite a bit about the link between Islam and violence. Case in point in Sam Huntington's study of Clash of Civilization, when he quotes, when he basically states that Islam has bloody borders. More recent studies by Toft would also claim that, or try to look into the puzzle of Islam and civil violence, but empirical studies seem to be inconclusive, and where we do find them, they've been criticized for the fact that many other factors are not being controlled for. So everything would just go under the umbrella of Islam, but these are the countries that also have a lot of oil, which is associated with conflict, lower socioeconomic development, which is also associated with conflict, state repression and such. There is a study that's supposed to come out this month at the International Interactions, which in a way provides a fresh statistical overview of this claim. Here, though, I'd like to start theorizing about the more nuanced way of linking Islam with nonviolence or violence. That it's not necessarily that Muslims are inherently violent or that they're always nonviolent, but rather we should probably look into the conditions under which they may become more violent or nonviolent. And again, looking into the literature on strategic nonviolence, there is one factor that comes out, which basically says that the nonviolent actions are likely to succeed when there is a great potential for the movement to recruit new members and actually be a mass movement. Under such conditions, the state is likely to basically acquiesce. And just thinking from a rational choice perspective, I guess you would choose to employ nonviolence when your strength is in numbers. So perhaps in the Muslim majority states, you are likely to have a choice of nonviolent actions than not. So again, some quotes from this particular literature. I then basically, here's my key explanatory variables. 1 minute. Which speaks about the adherence to a Muslim tradition, both at the state level and the level of the ethnic group. And now I'm looking into the proportion of the years when nonviolence was used as opposed to other tactics. I did use the minorities at risk data. Now that would basically have certain selections, and I had 115 groups over the period since the end of the Second World War to 2000. I did use the ordinal least squares, which would allow us to make the association and actually gauge the direction and the amount of effects. In the sample overall, we do have, the Muslim association with nonviolence is negative. However, when we divide the sample into two, in the Muslim majority states, it seems that civil wars, ethnic wars, are not really associated that much with the Muslim tradition, with the Muslim share in population. Similarly, the adherence of an Islam, of an ethnic group to Islam is not associated with violence or nonviolence either. So again, it's a very fresh start, and of course, more has to be done in the future. But in all of the models that I had, actually, one variable that consistently seems to be important is the level of grievances, relative deprivation. Consequently, if anything, yes, if in the Muslim minority states, Muslims seem to be more violent, then perhaps we need to look into the conditions which can elevate this particular strife. And I should end there.